bad eyes of people, but when people realize the truth, they see the truth is much bigger than family.
Don't worry about
them. Yeah, I'm not about you. Other people. You're already said you don't have any problems with that. Alhamdulillah. But I'm just saying, once people realize sincerely that truth is bigger than our families, our friends, our job, our studies, and so on, you will embrace it. You know that truth is what will set you free from, you know, this the problems that we are all facing. Alhamdulillah, that this, the first pillar of Islam, is something that you already will find it very easy. So, coming back to the first part of your question, about a little bit more about Islam. So, what Islam tells us is this: Islam is not a new religion. Islam is not a new ideology. It is, in fact, the finality of prophethood and messengership. Finality. That means this message has been throughout human history from day one, starting with Adam alayhi salam, Prophet Adam, the first human being that Allah created, from which we all have descended. Came up with Islam, and all the prophets and messengers subsequently that came after, they all brought the same message of pure and sincere and willing submission to our Lord, our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and worship Him alone. That has been the consistent message. So when Ibrahim alayhi salam, when he came to his people, he didn't say, I have come with Judaism or Christianity or some kind of other isms and so on. He came simply to tell people, submit yourself to the will of God. Surrender your will to the will of God. Like I have surrendered my will to the will of my Creator. By doing that, he has become a Muslim, and what he's following and what he's asking people to follow is Islam. Islam, as you now realize, is the submission and surrender of oneself to the will of our Creator. And the one who does that submission is called a Muslim. So in that light, Moses the Prophet, Jesus the Prophet, peace be upon all of the Prophets, they did exactly that. Submitted and surrendered their will to the will of their Creator and asked people to do so. So there were Muslims asking people to embrace Islam. Islam is an Arabic word and Muslim is an Arabic word. That's why people are a little bit reluctant saying, is that a new religion like from Arabia, from the Arabs? But if you think about it, the concept is submission and surrender of one's will to the will of their Creator without putting any partners to this Creator. That is what we are asking for. That is what Allah has been asking for. So throughout these times in human history, prophets and messengers did these things. When Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was raised as a prophet in Arabia, how was he known? He was known as Sadiq al-Amin, the truthful, trustworthy individual by his own people. His own people testified that he was someone who didn't speak a lie and was reliable in terms of his trustworthiness. If you were to give something, say, okay, keep this in your possession, he will keep it and secure it and he will return it back to you. That is how reliable and trustworthy he was. That's how he was known as Sadiq al-Amin. Ruh al-Amin, Sadiq al-Amin. This is how he was known to his people. He was not known to be someone who would go and worship idols. His community were idol worshippers. The bulk of it, the majority of it. They would erect idols from date stones, from wood, from stones, and carve them with their own hands and say these are gods who we worshipped so that they can bring us closer to God because we can't go to God directly. But as you realize, you don't need an intermediary to go to God because God hears us and sees us without any limitations. In fact, there's nothing hidden from God and there's nothing unknown from the knowledge of God. Yeah, He's all aware. The subtle, the one who sees and comprehends everything. He comprehends every vision, but every vision doesn't comprehend him. So when we say that Prophet Muhammad came with this call, he was supplemented with proof and evidence for his prophethood. Because anyone can come and say, I'm a prophet of God. So how do one ascertain that Prophet Muhammad was a prophet of God? Not only by his character, by his person, that when people heard him saying, yes, God has made me a prophet, I ask you to worship none but God and abandon the worship of false God, it was sufficient for them because of his trustworthiness and truthfulness. But he came up with the Quran that God sent him. the Quran being a revelation in such a way that it's been produced, even the Quran gives the falsification test for it. The Quran says, if you are in doubt as to what we, Allah, what God has revealed to his slave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then this is the way you can disprove it. The Quran says in chapter 2, Surah Al-Baqarah, produce a chapter like unto it. Seek helpers and supporters if you can't do it yourself besides Allah. If you are truthful in your doubts. And Allah continues by saying, but know that even if you try to do so, you won't be able to do so. But know for sure the hellfire is prepared for those who reject God, those people who disbelieve in God and so on, for the disbelievers. So the Quran gave them an opportunity to prove or disprove the Quran and the message of Islam by saying, look, this is Quran from God in a way it's delivered to you. You should be able to match something like it if you think this is a human speech. If you think this is a product of Prophet Muhammad ﷺ himself, you should be able to match something like it. The Quran is not a book of prose. It's not a book of poetry, but it has rhythm. It resonates with your heart. It has what we call naghma, and you find that, okay, it has this tone that it's finely tuned with your heart and your mind. Yet it's not prose or it's not poetry, which is something that they had in their customary literature. The Arabs had prose and poetries and the soothsayer sayings, but the Quran came in a genre, in a particular style. They knew that this is not something that they can themselves produce. Why? Because if it was within their capability, they were able to do that. So even their best poets at that time, it says, "Kalaysa hadha kalam al-bashar." This is not the sayings of a human being. This is not the statements of a human being. Why? Because they are not able to match something. So the Quran, the scholars have demonstrated through objective analysis that the way it is constructed, it is beyond their capacity to compose this stylistics of the Quran. So this is what we call the I'jaz al-Quran, the miracle of the Quran in the language. But some of us may not appreciate the language and the challenge that it provides in its falsification test. The Quran says, had this book been from any other than God, you should find within it many discrepancies, many contradictions and many errors. So it's given us another opportunity for the critics, for the people who have not yet believed, to examine the Quran and disprove it. Because the Quran says, if it wasn't from God, then there will be many discrepancies. And we understand that. A book that talks about history, past, present, as well as things in the future, the book that talks about economics, sociology, biology, astrophysics, warfare, the Quran talks about all aspects of life, from science to sociology and so on. If the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was a human being like them, he's bound to make mistakes here and there in those fields. He's bound to make mistakes in science, in history, or even things to come in the future. Because human beings don't know the future. We don't know the future. So if he used to say something that will happen in the future and he gets it wrong, then know for sure that the Quran is not from God. So when the Quran challenged people to say, look, even if the whole of mankind came together with the jinns, another creation of God, they would not be able to produce a book like the Quran. So the challenge and the falsification test is open to people. And for the last 1440 something years, people have been trying. They have been trying, and you will see in the internet how people are trying and trying. And yet they're unable to bring something that stands to scrutiny and saying, yes, this is an error in the Quran. Yes, this is a mistake in the Quran. Yes, this is a contradiction in the Quran. You'll find that for the last how many years, even before the advent of the cameras, we have been coming here to clarify these so-called contradictions people have in their mind by surface reading. When the Quran says, have you not read the Quran with care and deep reflection? If you did this, you would not find any contradictions. What people do is read a translation which is mistranslated somehow, or misleading translation, and they say, oh, there you go, that's the contradiction. Not going to the Arabic itself. Not going to see what the Quran in the Arabic language has to say. Yeah? So it is imperative that if people realize that the Quran is free from all these contradictions, when it should be full of contradictions, because of the way it talks about things, past, present, future, and all the aspects of life and all the sciences, how is it that it is free from contradictions? The only one who is able to deliver a book free from these errors and contradictions and inconsistencies is the all-wise creator of the heavens and the earth. So this guarantees and gives us the confidence as Muslims and those who are eager to learn and embrace Islam, the confidence to accept it and believe in it. That is why Islam is something that gives us the tranquility in our heart and in our mind, knowing about this truth. Because when we recognize this truth, we see that this is evident for itself that it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One then needs to just simply, you know, say, yes, I have no other reason to somehow stop myself from accepting it and embracing this beautiful message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which He has given to all of us, so that none of us can have any question or argumentation in the hereafter saying, I didn't know, that you didn't tell me, that you did not provide me with these evidence and justifications for belief. So having heard about the basis of how one can prove and disprove Islam by looking at the falsification test, and knowing that this is the case with Islam for the last 1400 years, this should give you an iman boost, what we call the faith boost, to say, alhamdulillah, at least now I understand why this one quarter or more of the population of the world is firm in their faith because of the truth that is embedded within it. And you should have no reason to say, why am I going to delay any further? So, I mean, I can go on talking, but I don't know exactly and specifically if you have any questions that you want to ask. Otherwise, bismillah, you know, otherwise, you know, just, you know, come to Islam with the hearts that has already accepted. Just declare with your tongue and affirm the truth and start manifesting with your limbs, so that you are grateful that you are already now, and you demonstrate your gratefulness to Allah, your creator, subhanahu wa ta'ala.
What you spoke about is making me understand it a lot more. I don't really have any questions.
Okay. So do you feel that you're ready to give the shahada, which is this testimony of declaration to affirm the proof?
You've read the Quran.
Yeah.
In the language you understand.
Excuse me, if you do not interrupt when we are discussing this, if you have any questions, we can talk about it, right? So again, I'm asking you again, with your own sound judgment, do you feel that you are ready to give the shahada?
I feel that I am ready.
Alhamdulillah. So it's quite easy, brother. What needs to be done is a process of saying a statement, right? That statement, I will say that in Arabic first, and I will tell you in English. And you just repeat the statements verbatim, the Arabic, and that is it. It's
but
not something.
I wanted to go to with some like people. I wanted to go to the mosque and do it.
Up to you.
I didn't want to do it.
Look. If no one's gonna force you to do the shahada, but if you want to do the shahada because you feel that yes, I don't want to delay it. I don't want to delay because now I know the truth and I want people to be encouraged by it. I want those people who are listening and watching my story, you know, to take those steps forward. You know, it's something that we would appreciate if you did. But I am not going to say that you have to. I mean, this is up to you.
No, this is the way I wanted to do it, like with the people and where I wanted to go to do it. That's the only reason why I want to do it now. It's not because I don't want to. Tomorrow is when I want to go and do it.
No problem whatsoever. No problem whatsoever. You do your shahada, declaration of faith, whenever you feel, wherever you feel that you are happy to do it. No one's going to force you. But make sure that, as you can just immediately see, there are forces around from people and from other creation of God that will try to stop you from doing that. As you realize, just the moment I was asking this question, there was this individual that came, right?
Someone else is going to tell me.
No, no, no. What I'm saying is, just bear this in mind. But, you know, make yourself a firm resolve, inshallah, not to delay it. Okay? I mean, do you know whether...
What I believe, not what other people believe.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. So, what I'm saying is, because we don't know when our death will come to us, right? We should not, when we know the truth, this is the scholars of Islam has told us, not to delay in accepting Islam, because it's already in the heart, but we haven't declared it. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even on the deathbed of his uncle, he was asking him constantly, just declare, because this will save you from the hellfire. Because once we declare the shahada, this becomes the key to Jannah, to paradise. So that eventually, if we, you know, when I say eventually, there might be some things that we have done for which we have to be cleanse ourselves, being by punished in the hereafter. But eventually, all of the believers who believe in La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah will come to Jannah, paradise, and stay in them forever. That is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it is not wise to delay it, but I'm not going to make that decision. You make that decision for yourself.
I'm not delaying it at all. I want to do it the way I want to.
Alhamdulillah, no problem, brother. Okay? So I hope and I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keeps you firm in your faith until we meet you again in Speaker's Corner, inshallah, as a Muslim.
Next Sunday.
Inshallah. Yeah?
I'd like to come here.
Okay, let's leave it to that. So organize yourself, inshallah, to go to a mosque. Is it a mosque that you want to go to? Yeah? And don't delay, inshallah, ta'ala. Okay?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. You're more than welcome, my brother. Inshallah, you will be a brother in Islam next time I see you. Now, you're already a Muslim in the heart, but you just need to come to a Muslim by declaration, inshallah ta'ala. Okay? May Allah guide us all closer and closer to the truth and remain us firm in the truth of Islam. Okay? Thank you, brother. Okay? There's a translation of the Quran. If you have this particular translation, okay, you can take it. No problem. Okay, thank you.